In January of 1926, the Metropolitan Opera Company began the search for a site to house the new Metro Opera House. The new development called for extensive commercial space alongside the opera house in an attempt to curb the company's running deficits. Benjamin Morris and other architects were invited to prepare proposals for the selected properties. During this time, Morris visited theaters throughout Europe. This trip convinced him that the new opera house should be a grand institution and that the commercial development would undermine it. Morris wanted the Metro Opera House to be so grand that it would rival the Paris Opera House, which inspired Morris to create large plazas and promenades in all his subsequent proposals. It was highly controversial in the late 20s to introduce such vast amounts of non-revenue-producing open space, but Morris argued it was a matter of civic pride. Columbia University approached the Metropolitan Opera Company about using a block they own, bounded by 5th and 6th Avenue, in an attempt to improve the quality of the area. The location was perfect, but Morris was struggling to create a large-scale opera house with enough commercial space to financially compensate for the opera's deficits, without undermining the grandeur appearance of the opera house. Morris suggested developing both adjacent blocks with the opera house as a central hub. The increased space would subsequently allow for more supporting revenue. In May of 1928, Morris produced the first proposal for the three-block site with the opera house in the middle of the complex and a grand plaza situated in front. There were a total of three 30-story towers located in the north, south, and east sides of the plaza. Each tower housed large arcades connected by cross streets to an elevated promenade. This proposal gave the opera house a grand setting, but the on-program space was financially questionable. Despite this shortcoming, the Metropolitan Opera Company was thrilled with the spirit of the project. In May of 1928, the Metropolitan Opera Company used this proposal as promotional material to acquire financial aid for the project. Among the potential supporters was a John D. Rockefeller Jr. Several architects were hired to study the new development individually and propose their perceptions of the site. Corbett, Harrison, and McMurray proposed a scheme following Morris's proposal, but they gave a much greater emphasis to the public realm. The raised promenade in Morris's proposal was increased to encompass the whole opera house. From these studies, Rockefeller deemed the focus of the opera house and its public realm an impediment to the project. The stock market crash in 1929 shifted the project's focus from the emotional appeal of an opera house to the need for financial stability and business towers. The opera house was forced to withdraw from the new development in January of 1930. Withdrawal of the opera house led the design team to push all previous studies aside and start a new development known as G3. The G3 scheme differed from Morris's initial proposal in one significant way. The opera house was to be replaced with a 50-story office building. While arcades, promenades, and plazas still remained the focal point amongst the office towers. It was at this point that the RCA became interested in the development. The Radio Corporation of America was a leader in technology and was looking to create a new cultural hub. RCA agreed to lease the center tower along with both adjacent blocks. This concept presented a brilliant shift in intention from an opera house as a traditional civic monument to a building celebrating a world-spanning technology. The building would symbolize technology that could bring culture to everyone. In July of 1930, Hood and Corbett proposed a new, unified development with the goals of the new tenants in mind. Large theater venues would flank the main tower on the ground floor. The theaters would be connected through a great forum that cut through the lobby of the main tower. This was to be one of the great urban experiences of its age. However, the development team feared that connecting all the venues would impede on future developments and renovations. In one of the final proposals, the Great Forum was replaced with an underground concourse connecting the buildings and providing more retail space. An oval-shaped building for a bank on the bottom of Fifth Avenue was proposed and later removed due to overwhelming public criticism. With very few revisions, this scheme would become what we know today as the Rockefeller Center.
Thank you.
British Empire Building, built 1937. International Building, built 1935. Radio City Music Hall, built 1932. 10 Rockefeller Plaza, formerly known as the Eastern Airlines Building, built 1940. 1 Rockefeller Plaza, formerly known as the Time Life Building, built 1937. The Comcast Building, formerly known as the RCA Building, built 1933. NBC studios and offices occupied the majority of this building. The first 8 floors host larger studios where SNL and The Today Show are filmed. While the creation of the plaza was rooted in the idea of a grand public institution that no longer exists, the ideal of the public sphere still remains. Following the withdrawal of the Opera House, the plaza became an enclosed arcade filled with fountains and dense planting. During the Forum scheme, the plaza became an opportunity to connect the surrounding streets with the concourse shops. The plaza was sunken to expose the underground walkways to the street level above. In 1932, the plaza was built with a large central staircase on the west of the plaza, which led the pedestrians into the concourse. The success of Radio City in the subsequent years meant that the shops in the concourse no longer relied on the plaza connection. In 1936, the plaza began to be used as an exhibition space, and in 1939, the Grand Central Staircase was removed. The removal of the central staircase transformed the plaza from a utilitarian concourse entrance into the multipurpose public stage it is known as today. Raymond Hood led the proposal for the rooftop gardens on the lower buildings. Hood was heavily influenced by the late 19th century utopian literature which emphasized integration of green space, such as rooftop gardens, into urban life. The garden idea of utopia was a critical response to the Industrial Revolution. The initial proposal for the rooftop gardens was a 7-acre park spread over the whole complex, including a variety of green spaces, a tea garden, an open-air sculpture exhibit, a concert venue, restaurants, and greenhouses. Only fragments of the initial proposal remained, as financial limitations of the project could not support the park plan. The rooftop gardens found today are modest in comparison to the visions of Raymond Hood. However, Hood's vision of the urban city overlooking diverse gardens is a great influence on future rooftops. The step levels of the Rockefeller Center are able to create an immersive space for public interaction. The towers cradle different layers of public realms, including sunken plazas and rooftop gardens. The public is drawn into these spaces, creating opportunities for more intimate and shared experiences. Far from being the result of cautious planning, the whole development of Radio City was instead the result of coincidence, evolutionary change, and brilliant speculation. Just as the buildings evolved out of misplanned and unforeseen circumstances, so did the institutions they housed. The Rockefeller Center is a marriage of classical and romantic ideals for the public realm and the reality of financial viability.